wheat. Do not each of you on the Sabbath lose his ox and his ass from the stall and lead them away to watering? And ought this woman, being a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan had bound, lo, these 18 years, be loosed from his bound, from this bond on the Sabbath day? And when he had said these things, all his adversaries were ashamed. All your adversaries will be ashamed. Amen. God will put them to shame. Amen. And all the people rejoiced for all the glorious things that were done by him. The Lord bless the reading of his word in our hearts in Jesus' name. Amen. 2 weeks ago, I told us the story of how the devil afflicted me with sicknesses and diseases until I grew up in Christ to know my rights as a child of God. And from the moment I knew my rights, I began to deal with the devil. And I told you that I know that I have an anointing in the area of healing and deliverance. How do I know? Because there have been cases that have been written off by the hospital, by the doctors, that God used me to heal. So on Thursday of that week, my son said he had headache, jaw, and I ignored it because I assumed that he was just trying to play smart on me, because that morning before he went to school, he was just in a world of his own. So I thought he just wanted to get, you know, my attention so that he won't get into trouble for what he did. And then later on, I realized that it was running temperature, and then he vomited. So when he vomited, I knew that he wasn't pretending about it. I knew that he was really unwell. So I immediately remembered what I said on Sunday, and I know that the devil came to try me out. So I told him, I know where to keep you. I'll keep you where you belong. That's hell. So I told my son to say some prayers. I prayed over him, and immediately God healed him and he became very well. Praise the name of our Lord. Praise the name of our Lord. And for those in church that Sunday, I said that God wants to prove his anointing in your life by solving your own problem first. That if you said you are anointed, he wants to solve your problem before he begins to use you to solve other people's problem. And we refer to the case of Elisha. After he had contacted the double portion of the anointing of God in the book of 1 Kings chapter 2, the Bible says that as he was going over, he encountered Jordan. And he would have been embarrassed if there was no solution, if God didn't solve his problem at that stage. But God solved his problem by causing the river to part for him. And immediately that happened, the sons of the prophet, they bowed to him. They recognized that he carried anointing. And then the community, because they saw that he was able to solve his own personal problem, they approached him. They said to him, in that book of 1 Kings chapter 2, verses 19 to 22, they said to him, we have a problem here. We have water that is bitter. Can you do something about it? And because he was able to solve his own personal problem, he was confident to solve a national problem or a community problem. And we said this even concerning the life of David as well. That David gave testimony in the book of 1 Samuel chapter 17, if you read verses 34 and 35, he gave testimony. He said that when the lion came against me, I slew it. When the bear came against me, I slew it. So I know, because I've proven it in my personal life, that this Goliath, which is a national problem, will also go, because I can prove that I am anointed. Praise the name of the Lord. So we said that God wants you to try the anointing. You are anointed. As long as you have the Holy Spirit inside of you, you are anointed. The Bible says that you will receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you. And in Acts 10:38 that we had, it was mentioned earlier on today, the Bible says that the how God anointed Jesus Christ of Nazareth with Holy Ghost and power. So God anoints men with Holy Ghost. So when you have the Holy Ghost, you have the anointing. And don't let anybody say that anointing is for certain people. Anointing is for every child of God. Praise the name of our Lord. And to prove this further, Jesus said to Peter in the book of Luke chapter 22 verse 32. Luke 22 verse 32. He said, when you become strong, strengthen thy brethren. So until you have proven the anointing in your life, there is really no basis for you trying to use the anointing that be caught out there, because it is not proven. You have to be able to use the anointing to solve your own personal problem first. And that is why I know that if there's been any more issues in your life today, God will put an end to it in the mighty name of Jesus. For from this we conclude that God designed that the anointing will help you solve your personal problem and then overflow into your family, overflow into your neighborhood, overflow into your community, and overflow into your nation. And that will be your experience from now on in the mighty name of Jesus. Now, against this background, let us now look at the story we read in the book of Luke chapter 13 from verses 10 to 17. Luke 13, 10 to 17 that we read earlier. We read the story of this woman that she was in the synagogue, because Jesus was in the synagogue on a Sunday like this and he was teaching. And the Bible says he saw this woman. He was the one that saw this woman, and he saw that she was bent over. So as Jesus was in the temple, as he was preaching, as he was ministering, he was looking around to look at the people. And then he saw this woman. So what's wrong with this woman? You know, every time everybody jumps up to shout hallelujah, this woman was just on the same spot. So Jesus paid attention to her and said, what is the problem? This woman, and then she realized that she was bent over. Now, when somebody is bent over, you know that that person is likely to be looking down. The person is not going to be able to see far. The person, the sight will be short-sighted. You can just see around where you are. You can't see far. So we saw that this woman in this story, probably, and I believe it is true, was not able to see far. And the Bible says in the book of Psalm 29, verse 18, Psalm 29, verse, Proverbs 29, 18, sorry. Let me just be sure now. I'm sorry, Ben. Can I have Psalm 29, 18? I just want to be sure. Please. Oh, let me just quickly get it there. Okay, so it's Proverbs 29, 18. Proverbs 29, 18. The Bible says that where the people are, where there is no vision, people perish. So we see that this woman had no vision, and then she had problem. She wouldn't be able to see far. I want you to use that as a prayer point for yourself. If you are not able to see far, number one, you cannot go far. Because what you see determines how far you can go in life. A blurred vision is a blurred life. If your vision is blurry, you cannot go far. And you must go far as a child of God that is anointed by God. So I want you to please rest on your feet and pray for yourself. I want you to pray for yourself, because today is the day of salvation. You are going to say, Father, please rise on your feet and pray. Say, Father, heal and deliver me from every physical, spiritual, emotional condition that may block or blur my vision in the mighty name of Jesus. Every condition, spiritual, mental, emotional, marital, financial, that may blur or block my vision, Father, deliver me today and heal me completely in the name of Jesus Christ. Father, I'm asking, oh God, by the reason of the anointing that is already present, that you will deliver me, that you will heal me from every situation, every condition that may block my vision, that will not allow me to see far, that may not want me to go far in life. Father, Lord, today I pray that you will heal and deliver me. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. please have your seat. It's good to get up and down. It's good exercise. Amen. So in case you have not done your exercise this morning, by the time you go home, you may not need to do another. The second thing is that we know that this woman was crippled. And when, because she was crippled, that means that she couldn't move. You know, her movement was, you know, constrained. It was limited. She will not progress like other people. Other people will be taking strides. She will just be wobbling behind them. And you're going to please rise up again. I've warned you. And you're going to pray against every power that is limiting you. You're going to pray that your ankle legs will receive strength. That you'll be able to go far. That you'll be able to go fast. That you will achieve your purpose in life in the mighty name of Jesus. The Bible says in the book of 1 Kings chapter 18 verse 46. 1 Kings 18:46, that the hand of the Lord was upon Elijah and he was able to go faster than the fastest chariot. Please rise on your feet and say, Father, give strength to my legs so that I can catch up with and overtake those who have gone ahead of me in the mighty name of Jesus. Give strength to my legs. Give strength to my ankles. Give strength to my legs, oh God, so that I can go far, so that I can go fast, so that I can achieve my goal in life in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, give me strength to catch up with and overtake those who have gone ahead of me, even in the name of Jesus Christ. Grant strength to my legs, oh God, in the name of Jesus. Where others are flying, I will not be wobbling behind, in the mighty name of Jesus. When others are walking fast, when others are taking strides in life, I will not be wobbling, in the name of Jesus Christ. Father, Lord, grant strength unto my leg so that I can go fast, so that I can go far. In Jesus' name, we have prayed. Please sit down. We'll see that because she was bent and she was crippled, when others will be looking up, she was looking down. She was always looking down. People will be looking up, they will be getting help, but she was constantly and perpetually looking down. The Bible tells us in the book of Psalm 121 verse 1, the Bible says, I will lift up my eyes to the hills, from whence cometh my help. When people are able to look up, they are able to receive help. So we could see that this woman could not get help. You need help, I need help in our journey in life. Amen. The Bible tells us in the book of Psalm 3 verse 3 that God is the lifter up of our head. I see God lifting up the head of somebody today in the mighty name of Jesus. Please rest on your feet and say, Father, please deliver me from every power that wants to keep me down. I lift up my head today in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Father, lift up my head. Lift up my head. You are the lifter of the head of your people. For thou, O Lord, art my shield and the lifter up of my head. O God of heaven, lift up my head today in the mighty name of Jesus. Let my head be lifted up. Let my head be lifted up. In every area we have been bowed down, in every way where I cannot look up anymore because I'm embarrassed and I'm ashamed, oh God, take away my shame and lift up my head in the mighty name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus, remove everything that is shameful in my life. Take care of it today. Take care of anything that is shameful in my life in the name of Jesus. Whatever is keeping my head down, oh God of heaven, take care of it today in the name of Jesus. Oh Lord, lift up my head. Lift up my head. Lift up my head, oh God. You are the lifter up of the head of your children. Lift my head up. Lift up the head of my loved ones. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. You know, when you are constantly downcasted, it's a sign of shame. And when you have anything that causes you to be embarrassed or to be ashamed, it is something you need to call God into so that he can lift up your head. May your head be perpetually lifted up in Jesus' name. Please sit down. And the Bible tells us that she had a spirit of infirmity. Infirmity simply is a state of being weak. It is a state of being weak in health or body. which paints Ross a picture of somebody who was powerless, vulnerable, very weak, you know, somebody who was feeble. And the Bible says that those of us that have no strength, God increases strength. In the book of Isaiah chapter 29 from verses 40 from verses 29 to 31. Those who have no strength, God gives them strength. You are going to pray because we need strength to do a lot of things in life. You know, even the strong, they are struggling. How much more those who are weak? You need the strength of God to come upon your life, so that when others are giving up, you'll be standing strong. Amen. I need you to please rise up again and say, Father. Say, Father, increase your strength in my life. Increase your strength in my finances. Increase your strength in my marriage. Just in every area of your life, just begin to ask God to increase his strength. That strength will come upon your finances. When you say somebody is financially strong, that means that when others are giving 100, he's giving 1,000. And he's not even feeling it. That is being strong. Father, increase my strength. In my finances, increase my strength. In the ministry, increase my strength. In my marriage, increase my strength. In the name of Jesus Christ. Father, in every area of my life, increase my strength. Let me become strong. The Bible says, oh God, you helped Uzziah until he became very strong. Father, help me and make me strong. Increase your strength in my life. In Jesus mighty name we have prayed. Please sit down. And then we can conclude, because of the way this woman was, she was bent double and she was crippled, she wasn't able to look up. We could imagine that she was in a lot of pain. She was in a lot of pain. She was a woman that would constantly be in pain. I was listening to something yesterday, and they were saying that even these painkillers that some people take, that it is even not good for you. Painkillers supposed to kill pains, but they said it's not good for you. And I know, of course, they will write on every medicine that, you know, there may be side effects. So imagine somebody that probably was on painkiller for life. You know, she was constantly in pain. And that's the work of the devil, to inflict pain into our lives, to put pain, things that are, and that is why we go through painful situations, things that are very, very painful for our heart to bear. And that's the job of the devil. But thank God that Jesus came, that I and you may have life and have it more abundantly. So you are going to please rise on your feet again, and you're going to say, Father, take care of every pain in my life. Financial pain, marital pain, emotional pain, mental pain, every kind of pain. Father, take care of it and give me abundance of life in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Father, take care of everything painful, every pain in my life. Take care of it today and let me begin to enjoy abundance of life in every area of my life in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Please sit down again. So we can conclude that this woman, because the Bible says she had a spirit of affliction, she had so many other problems with it. You would imagine, like I said, she would be embarrassed, she might be ridiculed, they would be describing her. Say, don't you know that woman in the church that is always, you know, bent double? You know, she was ridiculed, she was mocked, she didn't like her life. I want to believe that she probably was barren, because I don't see her getting married, I don't see her having children. She was probably lonely. So it was, you know, and then I want to believe that she was also poor. Praise the name of the Lord. So this, you know, we all come together as a package because the devil decided to afflict her. Every unpleasant situation in your life, the Lord will take care of in the mighty name of Jesus. I said the Lord will take care of every unpleasant situation in your life, in my life, in our homes, in our families, in the mighty name of Jesus. But Jesus said that, you know, from the reaction of Jesus in verse 16 there, you will see that It was not the plan of Jesus that this woman would be in this pain. It was not the plan of God for this woman to be in this pain. The Bible says in verse 16, Jesus reacted when people were saying, why would this woman be delivered on a Sunday? He said, and all this woman, being a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan had bound, lo, these 18 years be loosed from this bond on the Sabbath day. And the Bible says in verse 17 that, you know, those people that were criticizing Jesus, they were ashamed. And then the people began to praise God. Furthermore, in the book of 1 John chapter 3, verse 8b, 1 John chapter 3, verse 8b, the Bible says that for this purpose the Son of God was manifested, so that he might destroy the works of the devil. And we know that if the devil's work, according to John 10, verse 10, a is to kill, to steal, and to destroy. But Jesus has come so that you and I will have life and have it more abundantly. Then in the book of Mark chapter 16, verses 17 to 18, the Bible says, this sign shall follow them that believe. In my name, they will cast out devils. They will speak with new tongues. They will take up serpents. If they eat any deadly thing, it shall by no means hurt them. They will lay hand on the sick and they will recover. So you will see that although the devil would come with all manners of evil, but it is not the plan of God for those things to be retained in our lives. And then the book of Luke chapter 10 verse 19. Luke chapter 10 verse 19 says, behold, I give unto you power to tread upon serpents and scorpions, and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. And then in Matthew chapter 18 verse 18. Matthew chapter 18 verse 18. It says, verily I say unto you, whatsoever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatsoever you lose on earth will be loosed in heaven. So it is clear from the word of God that the devil comes with affliction, with problem, with troubles and bondages, but God doesn't want that to be retained in anybody's life. He wants people to be freed. He wants people to enjoy abundance of life. He wants people to enjoy their own lives. Why would God want that? Why does God want people to be free? Why does God want people to be joyous, to be at peace? Why? The Bible tells us in the book of Revelation chapter 4 verse 11. Revelation chapter 4 verse 11. It says, thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power. Thou hast created all things. Why? For thy pleasure. For thy pleasure they were, and they were created. If you look at Exodus chapter 3 verse 12, Exodus 3:12, Exodus 4:23, Exodus 4:23, Exodus 8:1, you will see that the reason why God decided to move the children of Israel from the land of bondage to a promised land is so that they can serve him. God wants people to be liberated. He wants people to be delivered so that they can serve him. He wants you to be delivered and then to be a vehicle for him to convey deliverance and healing to your neighbors, to your community, to the nation, so that your nation can serve him, so that your community can serve him, so that your neighbors can serve him, so that your family can serve him. And that is why it all starts with you. He does this for you so that you can serve him. And then he doesn't want you to stop there. He wants you to move out and begin to tell people what he can do, so that when everybody gets free, they can serve him. God wants us to serve him in joy. He wants us to serve him with everything he has blessed us with. So you are going to please rise up and pray. Please rise up and pray. We are praying for our community now. You are going to say, Father, anoint me and use me to bring healing and deliverance to my community, so that my community can serve you in the name of Jesus Christ. God wants me to bring deliverance and healing to my community, so that my community can serve him. Father, anoint me for this purpose, to bring healing and deliverance to my community, so that my community can serve you in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Please sit down. In the book of Luke chapter 13 and verse 13, after Jesus has ministered healing and deliverance to this woman, the Bible says that this woman began to glorify God. Why would God want to anoint you? Why would God want to heal you? Why would God want to deliver you? So that after he has done that for you, he can use you to heal others. So that when others are healed, they will do what? They will glorify him. He wants men and women to glorify him. So he will do it for you and make you a vessel through which he can do the same, so that people around you can glorify him. God wants to be glorified in every life. He wants to be glorified in your neighbor's life. You know, sometimes you look at them and we say, oh, this one is beyond redemption. Who says? Once God is able to do something in the life of that person, the person will begin to give glory to God. We saw that case in the case of this woman. After Jesus has healed her, the Bible says she began to glorify God. I want you to please rise up again and say, Father, release your anointing upon me afresh, so that I can deliver men and women from every form of bondage, and so that they can also give all the glory to you in the name of Jesus. Anoint me afresh. Anoint me, O God, to deliver men and women from every form of bondage, so that they can give you glory. So that they can give you glory. So that they can give you glory. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Amen. And then finally, you see, please sit down. In that book of Acts chapter 3, verse 8. That book of Acts chapter 3, we read verse 5 earlier on. Verse 8 says that the man, the crippled man at the beautiful gate, after he encountered Jesus, after Peter and John prayed for him, the Bible says he got up in verse 8. He stood up, he began to leap. He began to glorify God. He began to skip. He became so excited. And his life became a show that people began to say, see what God has done in the life of this person. When God uses you to bring deliverance, healing, and salvation to your community, the effect of it is that people will begin to leap. People will begin to jump. People will begin to praise God. And I know that you want people to praise God in your community. You want people to praise God in your neighborhood. And that is why you are going to please rise up again and you are going to say, Father, give me and make the lame. Make the lame to walk in my community, so that my community can stand and leap and skip and praise you in the name of Jesus. Use me to heal the lame, to cause the lame to walk, so that the lame can begin to stand, can begin to skip, can begin to leap, and begin to praise you in my community. Everyone that is lame, lame in their legs, lame in their finances, lame in any part of their life, Father, use me to heal their lameness, so that they can skip and stand and leap and praise you. In Jesus' name, we have prayed. Finally, please sit down as I bring this to a conclusion. This is why it is extremely important for you and I to be involved in evangelism, in going to our community. You see, until you go to people, you don't know the pains they are going through. A lot of people that you see in big, big cars, in big, big houses, they are going through pains that cannot be explained. A lot of them are suicidal. A lot of them are hopeless. A lot of them are on drugs. They can't see any way out. They have been battered by the devil. So don't ever judge a book by its cover. Because somebody is looking nice and radiant, your neighbor, you just say, this one doesn't need Jesus. He needs Jesus more than you think. Or you think because somebody is such a bad person, this one is beyond redemption. Jesus came for that person. He came to heal that person, to save that person. So, and God expects you and I to go to our neighbors. And that is why he said in the book of Acts chapter 1 verse 8, that you will receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be what? My witnesses. God is anointing you. He has anointed you so that you can be his witnesses. He wants me to witness about him, to tell them that Jesus is good, to tell them that Jesus can heal them, to tell them that Jesus loves them. Some people have never heard that somebody loves them. They were raised up in abusive homes. They have never had the word love in their lives. And when you tell them love is a strange word in their dictionary. Jesus has given you so much love so that you can extend his love to the people around you. And that is why the word of God says in the book of Luke chapter 4 verses 18 and 19. Luke chapter 4 verses 18 and 19. He says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me. Now look at why he has anointed me. Do you have your Bible there? Let's look at why God has anointed me. Why God has anointed you. Why God decided to pour his anointing upon our lives. He says the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me too. The reason why God has anointed me. The reason why God has anointed you is to preach. To preach the gospel. What is the gospel? The good news to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted. So many hearts are broken. To preach deliverance to the captive, like that woman that we just read about. And the recovering of sight to the blind. We told us that anyone that is blind, anyone that is bent low by the devil cannot see far and cannot go far. So he wants you to preach recovering of sight to those who are blind. To set at liberty them that are bruised. To preach the acceptable year of the Lord. So the purpose of the anointing is to preach, to heal, to deliver. The reason why God has anointed you, or why God will anoint you, why he's so desirous of pouring his anointing upon you, is so that you can heal, you can preach, you can deliver. This is why God has decided to take care of those things that can hinder you. That is why he wants us to use the anointing on yourself. Prove it. The anointing upon your life is real. The next time somebody is sick around you, just take a step of faith. Say, I've not done this before. I want to pray on you. I want to pray for you. And see what God will do. He will amaze you. How would Elisha know that he was anointed until he got to River Jordan? And then he looked at the river. He said, I have to get to the other side. And this is a river. How do I do? What do I do? Then he said, oh, there is a mantle. There is an anointing. Every time you confront a problem, realize and recognize the anointing of God upon your life. The next thing is not to pick your phone and begin to look for somebody to pray for you. You are anointed of the Lord. Use the anointing to solve your problem. And that will give you confidence. The next time somebody tells you in your office that they have a problem, you will do what? Let me pray for you. The next time somebody says there is a child of a neighbor that is in trouble, say, no problem. Before you ring the ambulance, let me pray. And you'll be surprised, because it is not you that answers the prayer. It is God that does what? That answers the prayer. So, prove the anointing. And how do you really put the anointing to test? You were here when we watched the clip from our father and the Lord Bishop Oyedepo the other time, when he was talking about Jesus' heart towards evangelism. That a man went out there to go and preach, to go and tell the people the good news. All you have to do in preaching is just tell them what God has done for you. You don't need to know many scriptures. You don't need to say, I want to begin to quote scriptures. Just tell them, I used to be like this and now I'm like this. You're an example. Amen. So this man went to preach the gospel. But earlier on, according to the story, he was involved in an accident, and he had a metal rod inside one of his legs to help him, you know, maintain a bit of balance. So after he had preached and I believe won souls for Jesus, before he laid back to bed, Jesus said, now can we do some operation on you? I want to reward you for going out there. He slept, he woke up, he found the iron rod beside him, and his leg was completely made whole. True life story. Jesus is still in the business of doing wonders. He wants to do great and mighty things through you. But the first thing is, go out there, go to your neighbor, go to your colleague, go to the next person that is in trouble and say, Jesus can do it. And he will never fail. I know him. I put him to test several times. He had never failed, and he will not fail in your life in the name of Jesus. On Wednesday, by God's grace, we are going to be here again, 7 p.m. We are going back to the community. You need to see how excited we were the last time we went, because God has started to do wonders. And he will continue to do wonders in our lives and in our midst, in the mighty name of Jesus. I'd like you to finally rise up on your feet. As you take the last prayer point, one of the tools the devil puts in our hearts that it does not allow us to go out there and declare the word of God and his love to other people is fear. Fear of rejection. If I go now, will they not treat me somehow? Will they not, you know, be abusive? Will they not maybe pour water and things on me? Fear. All Jesus said is to go. And he said, lo, I am with you always. And when you have the God of heaven and earth with you always, then why should you be afraid? So you are going to say, Father, kill every fear in my heart. Every fear, everything that is holding me captive, that is not allowing me, I want to do this. I know it is the right thing. Father, every fear, everything that cripples me, that does not want me to go and spread the good news. Father, kill every form of fear in my heart today. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, I want to go on the rescue mission. I want to go out there and bring souls unto you. I want to heal the sick. I want to deliver the oppressed. I want to bring souls unto you. Jehovah, I pray that you remove every form of fear from my life. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, thank you, because it is done. Glory and honor to you.